Many of the tests are conducted while Eve is strapped into the wing, because Eve's body is an integral part of the aircraft. The wing has no steering controls, no flaps, no rudder. Eve uses his body to steer the wing.
Well, he turns by just putting his head on the one or the other side, and sometimes he assists that with his hand, sometimes even with the leg. He's acting as a human fuselage, so to say, and that's quite unique.
When he arches his back, he gains altitude. When he pushes his shoulders forward, he goes into a dive.
There's Yves Rossy, and I think the wing is open.
Amazing.
The wing is open. So our first critical moment, it's open. He is down. Is he flying?
It looks like he's stabilized. He's starting to make his climb.
There's that 90-degree turn you're talking
That's
about,
right.
Taking him out. He's out over the channel. There is Yves Rossy. There is no turning back now. He is over the English Channel and underway. Ladies and gentlemen, a historic flight has begun.
And what he's going to do as he approaches the ground is pull down on those toggles to flare, slow himself down just a little bit, and then come in for a nice landing.
Now There he is. Yves Rossy has landed in England.
And now he's in Edinburgh. Yves Rossy. And this equipment as well. Yves, welcome. This is quite amazing. Those sequences were shot over the last 3 years in various moments of your activities. There were many, many others. So it's possible to fly almost like a bird. What's this to be up there?
It's fun. It's fun. I don't have feathers, but I feel like a bird sometimes. It's really an unreal feeling, because normally you have a big things, a plane around you, and when I strap just this little harness, this little wing, I have really the feeling to be a bird.
How did you start to become Jetman?
It was about 20 years ago when I did discover free falling. When you go out of an airplane, you are almost naked, you take a position like that, and especially when you take a tracking position, you have the feeling that you are flying. And that's the nearest thing to the dream. You have no machine or around you.
But
you are just in the element. It's very short and only in one direction. So the idea was, okay, keep that feelings of freedom, but change the vector and increase the time.
Two technical questions. What's your top speed?
It's about 300 kilometers per hour before a looping. That means about 190 miles per hour.
And what's the weight of the equipment you're carrying?
When I exit full of kerosene, I'm about 55 kilos. I have 55 kilos on my back.
And you're not piloting. There is no handle, no steering, nothing. It's purely your body, and the wings become part of
yes,
the body, or vice versa.
That's really the goal, because if you put steering, then you reinvent the airplane. And I wanted to keep this freedom of movement. And it's really like the kid playing to the airplane. I want to go down like that. And up I climb, I turn. It's really pure flying. It's not steering, it's flight.
What kind of training do you do, you personally, for that?
Well, actually, I try to stay just fit. I don't do a special physical training. Just I try to keep my mobility through new activities, you know, so that I, for example, last winter I did begin with kite surfing, so new things, so you have to adapt. Because this is, I'm quite an experienced manager of system as pilot. But this is really, you need fluidity, you need to be agile and also to adapt very fast.
Somebody in the audience asked me, how does he breathe up there? Because you're going fast and you're up at 3,000 meters or so.
Yeah,
so.
Okay, up to 3,000 meters, it's not such a big problem with oxygen, but as you are, for example, bikers, they have the same speed. Just with the helmet, it's integral helmet, it's really no problem to breathe.
Describe for me the equipment, since we have it here. So,
yeah, briefly,
the wings, four engines.
Yeah, 2 meter span, auto-stable profile, four little engines, 22 kilos thrust each, turbines, with working with kerosene, harness, parachute. My only instruments are altimeter and time. That's my, I know I have about 8 minutes fuel, so just check before it's finished. And that's all. Two parachute, that means if I have a problem with the first one I pull, I still have the possibility to open the second one. And this is my life. That's the real important thing about safety. I did use that during these last 15 years about 20 times. Never with that type of wing, but at the beginning, yeah. I can release my wing when I am in a spin or in an unstable.
We saw the 2009 crossing of the Gibraltar
exactly.
Strait, where you lost control and then you dive down into the clouds and in the ocean.
Yeah.
So that was one of those cases where you left the wings go, right?
Yeah, I did try in clouds, but you lose completely orientation. So yeah. I did try to take again a climb attitude. I thought, okay, I will go out. But most probably I did something like that. Yeah. The next thing...
Something that is not very safe in,
no,
in image.
But you don't... You feel great, but you have not you have not the right attitude. So the next thing I saw was just blue. It was the sea. I have also an audible altimeter. So yeah. I was at my minimum altitude in that vector, fast. So pulled that. And then I did open my parachute.
So the wings go out with their own parachute,
yeah.
And you have your two parachutes.
Exactly. There is a rescue parachute for the wing for yeah. two reasons, so I can repair afterwards, and especially that nobody take that just
I see.
When he's
well, let's maybe come back here. But this is risky stuff indeed, right? People have died trying to do this kind of things. And you don't look like a crazy guy. You're a Swiss airline pilot, so you're rather a checklist kind of guy. I assume you have standards.
Yeah, I have no checklist for that.
Okay, let's not tell your employer.
No, that's really two worlds. Civil aviation is something that we know very well. We have 100 years of experience, and you can adapt really precisely. With that, I have adapt to something new. That means improvise. So it's really a play between these two approaches, something that I know very well. These principles, for example, we have two engines on an Airbus with only one engine, you can fly. So plan B, always a plan B. In a fighter, you have an ejection seat.
What's
that's
plan B
my
here?
Ejection seat. So I have the approach of a professional pilot with the respect of a pioneer in front of Mother Nature.
It's well said. It's well said. What happens is if one of the engines stops?
I do a roll, and then I stabilized, and according my altitude, I continue on two or three engines. It's sometimes possible. According, it's quite complicated to explain, but according at which regime I was, I can continue on two. And try to get a nice place to land, and then I open my parachute.
So the beginning of the flight is actually you jump off a plane or a helicopter, and you go on a dive, and you accelerate the engines, and then you basically take off midair somewhere. And then the landing, as we have seen arriving on this side of the channel, it's through a parachute. So just as a curiosity, where did you land when you flew over the Grand Canyon? Did you land on the rim, down at the bottom?
Yeah, it was down on the bottom. And I came back afterwards on the sled of the helicopter back.
Yeah.
But it was too stony and full of cactus on top also.
That's exactly why I asked the question.
Yeah, and also the currents are quite funny there. There is a big thermal activity, big difference in altitude also. So it was much safer for me to land at the bottom.
So I think that right now many people in the audience are asking, okay, when are you developing a double-seater so they can fly with you?
I have a standard answer. Have you ever seen tandem birds?
Perfect answer. Yves, one last question. What's next for you? What's next for Jetman?
First to instruct a younger guy. I want to share it, to do formation flights. I plan to start from a cliff, like catapulted from
so
a cliff.
So instead of jumping off a plane, yes?
Yes, with the final goal to take off, but with initial speed.
Yeah.
Really, I go step by step. It seems a little bit crazy, but it's not. It's possible to start already now. It's just too dangerous. Thanks the increase of the technology, better technology, it will be safe. And I hope it will be for everybody.
Yves, thank you very much. Yves Rossy.
Thank you.